Cornelia, over to you.
Very much. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our webinar, Innovation Opportunities and the Caribbean Reality, Considerations for a Regional Electric Vehicle Strategy. I see the attendee numbers are still climbing, so people are getting on to our webinar. We are right now at over 80 participants. My name is Cornelia Schenk. I'm a sustainable energy expert focusing on energy efficiency at the Caribbean Center for Renewable Energy and Energy Efficiency. And it's my great pleasure to moderate this event and lead you through the stream of thoughts of our panelists who are regional and global thought leaders and practitioners in electric mobility. We currently have 7 million electric vehicles on the world's roads and experience significant efficiency gains, but transport emissions still account for 24% of direct CO2 emissions from fuel combustion. Reducing these emissions will require sustained policy efforts to enhance efficiency and electrification, as well as to anticipate and manage transportation demand. These factors, combined with a more sustainable and diverse energy mix, is of particular importance for small island developing states, which are characterized by high fuel import dependencies and vulnerabilities to the impacts of climate change. So in this webinar, our panelists will explore some of the key enablers and barriers for a stronger uptake of electric vehicles, present the regional electric vehicle strategy framework to you, and also key considerations for the three strategic pillars of innovation, intelligence, and electrification, and will strive to get your thoughts on a range of topics. We had more than 200 participants registered for this webinar, ranging from private sector representatives, electric utilities, to governments, academia, and international organizations, not only from the wider Caribbean region, but also including representatives from regional centers for renewable energy and energy efficiency in Africa and in the Pacific Islands. Our webinar is packed with interventions from our panelists to reflect the multidimensional nature of electrifying the transportation sector, but we also want to ensure an interactive and engaging discussion. So we have created a suite of polls, which will show up on your screen and contain predefined answer options to receive your feedback within a short time frame. So we try to keep it between 30 seconds and 45 seconds to keep the overall flow of the webinar. Participants can post their questions in the Q&A box, which you see on the bottom. And the panelists will try to answer them throughout the webinar, and remaining questions can be addressed in the Q&A session at the end. We will start off our webinar with Dr. Devon Gardner, who has been the head of the Energy Unit at the CARICOM Secretariat since 2014. The Energy Unit is tasked with identifying common policies and strategies for transitioning the energy sector in the Caribbean towards greater efficiency and higher penetration of renewable energy sources. Dr. Gardner, welcome to the REPS webinar. The floor is yours to introduce us to the key motivations and priorities for including e-mobility in the CARICOM Energy Framework. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Cornelia, and good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's good to see the level of enthusiasm that is had in this webinar. I was actually quite elated when I saw the level of registration that we had yesterday. I'm now going to share my screen and go directly into the conversation, because we do not want to spend too much time on the matters that we have to cover here today. So I am pulling up my presentation, and I am then going to go into presentation mode. And my screen is being shared, I presume. Everyone's seen the presentation now? Cornelia, is the presentation
yes,
on?
Yes, we do.
Okay,
we do
great. Thank you. So, colleagues, the point is that the CARICOM Secretariat has been working with member states to advance sustainable energy matters in the region. In fact, since 2003, the heads of governments gave a mandate for there to be the development of a common energy policy that captures how we can best cooperate around energy within the Caribbean community. And of course, much has changed since 2003. And so the issue of how we cooperate and coordinate. I will start by providing some orientation because I know that not everybody on the webinar are necessarily familiar with the Caribbean community, or maybe even not from the Caribbean region as a whole, because we do have colleagues from the Pacific and other countries across the world. The countries in yellow are the ones that are members of the Caribbean, 15 of them stretching from Bahamas in the north down to Guyana and Suriname. It's a diverse set of countries with different geographical characteristics and sociopolitical dynamics, and you name it. Some are small islands, some are half of an island, some are larger islands, some are part of a continental shelf, but all of them are, of course, states. One thing that we find is that all of these countries really have high fossil fuel dependence. Very few of them actually are using indigenous fossil fuels. Trinidad and Tobago, Belize to a lesser extent, and nowadays Guyana, and of course Suriname are the ones that have known fossil fuel resources that are able to be utilized all of their energy needs. The others do not have, and so the diversity across countries in terms of resources is something that is interesting. Recognizing that, you know, there have been a lot of effort to figure out how to decouple the energy systems in the countries from imported fossil fuels, and even those who have indigenous resources. With the climate, global climate issues, there have been a lot of effort to decouple the sectors from energy from intensive fossil fuel use. Transport is one of the sectors, of course, naturally, that is under consideration. The power sector and the transport sector account for the lion's share of energy use in the countries. We see here some numbers that, well, at least some proportions that show you that transport in some countries account for over 50% in three countries based on the number and the latest set of data which we have available to us. And in most, in a majority of countries, it's over 30%. Are at least one third of the total energy use. So transport energy, the energy use in transport is important. So while we were addressing a lot related to the power sector, which seemed to be typically a simpler sector to address because it's much more consolidated. Typically you have one utility with regulations in some instances. You know, we recognize that the transport being more dispersed, more diverse, still required.
Dr. Gardner, please excuse the intervention, but your microphone is breaking off a little bit.
Oh, sorry. Are you hearing me now? Is it better?
Yes, right now it's better.
Okay, great. So I just want to point out that, you know, within the context of CARICOM's work in the energy sector, this is also coupled with global efforts on the climate agenda. And I'm not going to go into details on the climate agenda today because naturally all of you are here are aware of much of the global climate agenda and what has been pursued. But needless to say, transport and energy has emerged at the forefront of much of what has been discussed at the global climate level in terms of CARICOM. And in fact, in respect to the nationally determined contributions and the commitments of CARICOM countries, energy and transport appear significantly in all the NDCs for all countries. And I'm not going to go into the details here, but these slides will be made available to you. So this is really for your reference. This is really just to show that a significant number of the countries are really seeking to pursue energy and transport, if you want to call it work within the NDCs. In some instances, for instance, you know, there are distinct transport NDCs and distinct electricity. In the electricity sector and efficient vehicles in the transport sector. But, you know, with the convergence of electricity and transport, we expect that some of these NDCs in the revision will converge as there is electrification being introduced into transport in a large extent, so that electricity NDCs will, in fact, find themselves within the context of the transport NDCs. The CARICOM energy policy, in principle, is one that requires us to take individual actions where those actions are relevant and feasible. So countries are not bound to actions within the context of CARICOM energy policy. Nevertheless, we seek as far as is possible to identify those areas and options that can give a collective benefit to our countries through a cooperative approach. And that is really where we seek to do a majority of the exploitation and explorations within the context of the CARICOM energy policy. And in that regard, we typically practice as a principle of subsidiarity, where we provide regional treatment to those actions, which will give a comparative advantage to countries compared to if they were to do those items or actions by themselves. And so we find that within this context, we have framed some energy goals and visions for CARICOM, and it's really to look at how we can make more reliable, more affordable, such that the energy service needs can be matched according to the society. And that, you know, over time, we are able to provide from diverse energy resources, systems that are appropriate for the countries in general. And we look at how consumers' actions will benefit and how the infrastructure will be required to deliver those actions to the consumers, and look at really what kind of deliver sources, whether it is renewable sources and so on, would be required to deliver the energy to consumers. And then, of course, look at what is the framework that is necessary for supporting the full energy system architecture. And we have done quite a bit of work on that. There's a CARICOM energy policy since 2013 approved by ministers of energy. And with that, we developed a sustainable energy roadmap and strategy that articulates how the policy could be implemented in countries. What we try to do nowadays is to really look at the architecture of the power sector. And that we have done quite a bit of work on that, and see how it is that we can improve the architecture of the power sector, much more modern, much more reliable, much more effective, both in terms of cost and of course how it can become greener and cleaner in how we use and develop energy. We look to introduce different types of fuel options and diverse fuel options. We look to change the business practices and models of utilities and all of that. So in the typical traditional sense, this is what your power sector architecture looks like, you know, generation, transmission, distribution. Typically, the utility plays a role in this part of the process as it regards that, and the utility gets fuel mostly imported in many countries, generates, feeds it through the transmission distributed network, and it goes to the end users who then use that. Now, the opportunity that we are exploring to a large extent is looking at how it is we use in the generous resources, capture energy from those resources, where we use and store those resources as far as is necessary, so that we are able to feed it into a conversion process, which includes the transmission and distribution, link to storage, that brings us to an end use that allows you to do storage even at the end use state, and provide the energy. Naturally, we expect that within this context, the utility will participate end to end, and it will be a demand-driven approach rather than a supply-driven approach that was traditional. And within this context, we expect that in the end-use principles and considerations, this part here, which is in red, will also apply to the transport sector through electric vehicle technologies, which allow you to, you know, use vehicles as a conversion device with storage to provide consideration that we have integrated.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but we're still facing issues with the sound quality of your microphone. And as important as the IUS model implementation is for the region, please maybe try to wrap up the presentation to also account for the sound quality. Thank you very much.
Is it better now?
It is right now, but it keeps going on and off.
Okay, apologies for that. So at the end of the day, colleagues, what we are looking at is how we can build an end-to-end model that allows utilities to play a role. And in that model of the utilities playing a role in delivering services, including electric transport services, we would therefore be able to look at a strategy that guides and orientates national actions and lead to projects on the ground. And of course, the experiences of the projects from the ground go back up into informing improvements in national and regional level. That's the expectation and hope. And we have connected to that large extent at the regional level, at the high level. The sustainable energy roadmap and strategy at CARICOM is connected to the regional strategic plan. And then we have these sub-policies of the CCREEE, as we call it, that are linked up to the sustainable strategic plans. The strategic plan in the community has the climate change framework guiding it. It has a CDM, which is a comprehensive disaster management framework, and of course there's human resource. And within the context of the CSERBs, we are linking to how it is we can look at resilient, sustainable energy supplies. There's a regional energy efficiency strategy. There's a regional quality infrastructure for energy, which looks at buildings and appliances and equipment in buildings, including the building code, which is recently established through and was approved by ministers in 2018. And of course, there's the electric vehicle strategy, which is now being developed and disseminated. At country level, we are doing significant work to ensure that some of these have been tested on the ground in the countries, including Belize, Guyana, and Jamaica. We are now doing integrated resource and resilience planning that will test some of the climate resilience pieces that we are speaking about and some of the strategies, including the electric vehicle options and opportunities will be captured within the IRRP. Within that context, we are testing also how the utilities can provide the services through the integrated utility service model. And we are coupling all of that with support for policy and regulations through an help desk, which we are creating in the Secretariat, innovative financing models that we are establishing through the CDF and CDB, enhancement of capacity through the CCREEE and other entities, and of course, information and knowledge management through the CCREEE, as well as policy development assistance through our last slide. Really, what the hope and the aim is that in addressing our climate issues and seeking to do our part in adaptation, recognizing that adaptation will not necessarily be paid for or what usually we're calling the Annex One country. We recognize we have to adapt our systems to a large extent to ourselves, such that our food, water, energy, and other systems are appropriately capable of withstanding the climate impacts. And in so doing, by adapting our systems, we will adapt also to the socioeconomic developmental requirements of our people. And in that regard, we will be able to play our role in the global and pollution mitigation efforts that are ongoing. We see electric mobility as a big part of how it is that we will adapt our human systems to the anthropogenic changes in climate, recognizing that it gives us greater flexibility in respect to how we build out our mobility going forward. I'll stop here for the time being. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gardner, for this excellent preparing of the ground for our discussions. With this background, we will right move to the next speaker, Dr. Curtis Boudou, Assistant Professor in the Utilities Engineering Unit at the University of Trinidad and Tobago and a member of several national and international committees and boards, acting as the chairman of the Electric Vehicles Working Group that was convened by the CARICOM Energy Program. He will give us a quick run through of the REVS framework to explain how a transport electrification can effectively be achieved and an electric vehicle market in the Caribbean community supported. And for the participants, if you have not had the opportunity to review the REVS framework document, you can access it via the CCREEE website. Dr. Boudou, very much welcome, and over to you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Cornelia. I'm very excited to be here. Just please allow me a few moments to share my screen. Are you able to see?
We see your screen, yes.
Okay, great. All right, so I only have 8 minutes, so let me get started. So as Devon had mentioned in his presentation, a considerable percentage of our imported fuel in the region goes towards transportation. So you can see from the slide that we have a lot of countries in CARICOM that would consume over 40% of their imported fuel for transportation. So the goal here is to really try to reduce the importation of transportation fuel. And the way the best way to do this is to utilize indigenous sources of fuel or indigenous sources of energy. So in this case, it will be renewable energy, and the technology to use here would of course be electric vehicles. Devon also mentioned about the climate change commitments we have in CARICOM. So all the countries in the region have had commitments for climate change, and they have made significant commitments in the area of transportation. What countries have also done as well, they have put in place national policies that do encourage or do allow for the growth or the decrease in emissions in the transportation sector as well. In the region, the costs for gasoline, the cost for diesel remains very high. And when you compare that at the cost for electricity, especially the domestic cost for electricity or per kilowatt hour, there is a vast difference. So there is the driver of costs in terms of your fuel to really encourage the investment in electric vehicles or the electrification of transportation. Even though we gave some excellent reasons why we should invest in electric vehicles, the deployment of electric vehicles in the region still remains relatively small. On the left-hand side, you would see a slide that really needs to be updated, but on the right-hand side where we have some updated figures, you could see the overall deployment for electric vehicles is small in the region. So is there a justifiable reason to look at the REVs or the regional electric vehicle strategy? So I just gave four reasons. Ground transportation policy in the region is not as developed as energy policies. And this is at both the national and the regional level. So Devon would have mentioned that the energy policy for CARICOM was out since 2013. The CSERMS was approved in 2015. And at a regional level, we are now looking at the REVS framework. Of course, transportation is a complex issue that involves energy, tourism, urban planning, and social programs. But I believe now is the best time to look at transportation because with the electrification of transportation, there are a lot of natural synergies between transportation and energy. Of course, we would want to reduce our emissions and our imports. And we would want to prepare the region for the emerging technologies and models as it relates to transportation. So this is what the REVs looks like, especially when the team developed the REVs. We thought about it as a tempo. So we have the aim of the REVs being held on or being supported by three pillars, which we call strategic imperatives. So the pillars are innovation, intelligence, and electrification. Now, the reason for these three strategic pillars is to really try to harness whatever disruption we expect to occur in the transportation sector. And we are looking at the energy sector. So the disruptions that are taking place in the energy sector, authors like to describe them as the 3Ds: digitization, decarbonization, and decentralization. So we would see in the future a transition of the transportation sector towards these disruptors. So the goal of the pillars is really trying to harness the three disruptors. When we implement the pillars, we will implement it on these four broad implementation initiatives: finance, capacity, development, technology, policy, and regulation. So post-COVID-19, how would our rollout of the REVs be affected? So of course, we have a challenging economic environment. There is a decrease in automotive sales, and there is also a low global liquid fuel price. How does it affect the REVs? Well, I prefer to use this representation of the REVs rather than the tempo one, because I find this one more relevant, because innovation, intelligence, and electrification, they are very highly coupled. So I would say that post-COVID-19, when you look at the four implementation initiatives, countries may not be willing to offer the tax incentives that we currently have for the purchase of EVs. They may want to roll that back. So that may be a policy consideration. Of course, we hope that they keep these incentives for public transportation. In the area of technology and infrastructure, I believe countries we need to show them that the making an investment in infrastructure and technology will offset your fuel imports, you know, so that incremental cost would actually add value with you reducing your fuel imports. I feel the biggest gainer in post-COVID-19 is actually capacity development and awareness, because a lot of individuals are out of a job in their traditional sector in the region, being tourism or the automobile sector. And there is the opportunity to be trained or retrained in a field that is related to electric vehicles or the electrification of transportation. The most affected arm in terms of the implementation of the REVs is the finance, market development, and innovation arm. But if you do get the opportunity to go through the REVs framework document, the CCREEE there does address that issue with looking at grant funding and looking at project funding. So I believe I would have finished on time. Thank you for listening, Cornelia.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pudu, for this excellent introduction to the REVS framework. And before we move now into the discussion of the three pillars of innovation, intelligence, and electrification, we first wanted to ask a quick poll for our audience. Whether we have convinced you already, do you see a justifiable need for the REVS? And we will leave that open for a couple of seconds. So we see a 67, almost 70% participation in the polling. We will close the poll now to be able to continue with the webinar. And as you can see with the poll results, we have an overarching majority, 85% of participants that are convinced we really need a regional electric vehicle strategy, and a few others that we might still have to convince going forward. So thank you very much for participating. And we will move now to a quick overview of the global electric vehicle market trends for technology performance, costs and emissions, and the likely influences of these trends on the Caribbean, and then move into the discussion of the pillars innovation, intelligence, and electrification. Mr. Victor Buscani Valente and Mrs. Andrea Danzinger are both transport advisors and electric mobility experts at the German Agency for International Cooperation, GIZ, and they will share this intervention on the global perspectives. Mr. Buscani Valente, Mrs. Danzinger, we're very happy to have you join us to share your experiences. Over to you.
Sure. Hi. Everyone, I don't know if you can see my screen now.
Yes, we can see your screen. Thank you.
Perfect, thanks. So I'll try to be on time as well. Thank you very much for inviting us. Me and my colleague Andrea Danzinger, we're going to present very briefly the global trends and perspective on electromobility. We are representing here GIZ, the German Cooperation Agency, and I specifically work at an initiative here in Germany, but it's a global initiative called TumiVolt. That is, our goal is to really work on capacity development, coalition and networking building, pilot project, and also delivering until by 2005, enabling 100,000 e-buses around the world. Of course, we are not do with this alone, so we have many partners and inside this initiative. So yeah, starting the content is our projects, GIZ project on e-mobility global context and the considerations relevant towards the Caribbean region that Andrea will present. So GIZ, this is a very quick this is a map with the projects with GIZ have in the transport sector. And here I select some examples of the projects so you have an idea more or less what we are doing in terms of electromobility projects around the world. So in China, we have a longer relationship with China regarding electromobility. and we are working with them in the life cycle analysis, charging infrastructure development, battery recycling, electric car sharing, and standardization. In Thailand, promotion of electric 2- and 3-wheelers. So we are working also with not only in with buses. In Brazil, we have a project to incentivize and regulation strategy, business model, and pilot projects. And in Costa Rica, actually, Andrea will get more in detail on this project, introduction of electric buses in San Jose. Well, we know that the vehicles with internal combustion engine are a huge market, and compared to the number of electric vehicles, it's really tiny so far. But why we are discussing here, since it's just a drop in the ocean? Because the numbers have shown, so in the last couple of years, that the numbers of EVs and also electric vans, electric buses, and electric 2- and 3-wheelers especially, are growing steadily. And if you see 2017 to 2019, we doubled the number. Of course, it's still not enough when you talk or you compare with the combustion vehicles, but it's growing exponentially. And as you can see the red here, China is the driving the market when we look at electric vans, buses, and 2- and 3-wheelers. And the global forecast for further growth. So it's not like a mode or something that we will pass. We really expect that this market will grow and we'll have more electrical vehicles in the future. So, and if you can see here, I will go into detail afterward, but you see that this outlook here, this document already considers the drop due to COVID-19. Well, but our approach in GIZ is to avoid shifting, improving. This is very important to, you can see here, less polluting and noise in traffic jams shouldn't be our goal. So to have EVs, passenger vehicles, electric, for the climate helps, but for the whole urban mobility doesn't help that much. So we should really think of avoid shifting proof. That's why we are focusing at GIZ, the programs we will work on public transport. So buses and last mile technology. I just leave it here. So you can see afterwards in the presentation, this graphic. The main challenge that we are facing now are those, I mean, there are many, but those I would consider the main challenges, sustainability of raw materials, upfront cost, lack of knowledge, renewable energy supply, and charging infrastructure. I was asked to actually, and considering that we work in different countries, we know that one of the major issues when you're talking to decision makers is the cost. So this is the good news is, depending on the technology, we are expecting break-even points for the total cost of ownership in the next years, few years. So at least in the United States, Europe, and China, you can see here for city bus, United States 2005, Europe 2003, China 2004, and also for medium and light duty truck, not more than in the next 10 years. When we're talking about heavy duty truck, then it's different. Probably the technology won't be electric vehicles, but probably hydrogen or other technology, BTX, things like that. So this is important to consider. So you should really, if you are a decision maker, start to consider also that the cost of ownership will be soon. And because of the battery is play a very important role on that. And the prices are getting lower and lower. We are expecting this break even soon. My colleague already mentioned it, so I will just pass very fast here. The corona have an impact and not a so good impact, but you have also a good impact, which is an air quality. When you look at air quality, here's an image from India. before lockdown, after lockdown. So we should also consider that the climate change is there, bottom line is there, and we should invest in the transport sector on e-mobility, mainly because of this. And I hand over to my colleague now.
Good morning, everyone. Very nice to have the opportunity to present here. I would like to share with you some lessons learned from Latin America that are probably also relevant for the Caribbean. My name is Andrea Denzinger. I'm a transport advisor at the project Mi Transporte in Costa Rica. I would continue with the presentation of Victor because we are using the same one.
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
So we held a workshop in October here in Costa Rica with seven countries from Latin America, where we have identified lessons learned and recommendations to increase the use of electric vehicles. So the seven countries participated, and then we also had an expert review from international experts and also including two colleagues from the panel here. So these are the key recommendations. I will just highlight a few of them and recommend the publication that we just finished. It's in Spanish and in English, so you can just follow the link here on the screen and you will see the presentation. So we have some general recommendations combined with good examples, for example, from Uruguay, how they have cross-financed the transition to electric buses, or from Chile, their strategy to share the risk in their electric bus pilot project. So there's some really interesting highlights from Latin America. And yeah, let's see. Basically, everyone said, just get started. Don't wait too long until you have a comprehensive vision, but just to define some basic targets, define a clear vision. So you give a clear signal to the different stakeholders. And at the same time, don't wait for perfect conditions. So even if the electricity grid is not very clean yet, but there's no time to do another transition. So we have to work on both levels at the same time, cleaning the electricity grid and promoting electric mobility. Also, it was found important to have to ensure broad stakeholder participation, identifying leadership, and to identify actors that can drive the transition. Can be from the civil society, can be the electricity provider. And it's important to create spaces and platforms so that the actors can exchange and can also talk about doubts and limitations of electric mobility. Another point that was found very important is to create pilot projects to generate data in your own conditions, which informs then further decisions, creates trust, and shows basically on the ground how electric mobility can work. And also very important is to create a narrative that goes beyond only decarbonization, reducing emissions, but to highlight also that it's reducing the noise levels, that it's reducing air pollution, and also to communicate where are the limitations of electric mobility, for example, that it's not available for trucks, for heavy duty trucks. To tidy up a little bit the discussion, this helps a lot to cut out the myths and bad vibes, I would say, in the discussion. And also it's important to establish an enabling policy framework, for example, to create incentives. I will also share some examples for you from Costa Rica, because I think the conditions are quite similar. Because, for example, here in Costa Rica, the country is very small, so there's a very small market, and the interest from, let's say, car producing companies is not that great because of the limited potential to sell vehicles here. So I think you have to start working on electric mobility differently than, for example, in Mexico or in Brazil, where you will have an offer in any case, because there's a competition between the different suppliers. So next slide, please. Okay, here's a short overview on the incentives that different countries have given in Latin America. For example, many countries are working with incentives on the purchase of electric vehicles. Some also give user incentives, for example, the exception from driving restrictions or from road charges or parking fees. So this is also something that can have a very big influence if you have, for example, companies that depend on access to city centers that may have air pollution restrictions, for example. And here you can see that in Costa Rica, how it had an impact also. Because in 2018, the law of incentives was released, and then you can see how this curve grows, and especially in the private vehicle segment. We will also share the slides with you later on, so you can have a deeper look in detail if you're interested. Next slide, please. And over next, because the next I'm going to skip due to time restraints.
Okay, please.
The following, please. Yeah. Okay, so let's have a brief look at Costa Rica, because I think there's really something that other countries can learn from Costa Rica. First, as you may know, Costa Rica has a very ambitious climate agenda and a lot of political support to shift toward electric vehicles. And I think this is a very important signal for the different stakeholders that you identify what is the roadmap, where do you want to head towards. So there's a decarbonization plan and three of these 10 Eches of these 10 strategies are focusing on transportation. And I mean, yes, there's already a very clean electricity grid, so the conditions here are quite positive. And there are already quite a few milestones achieved, for example, with this law of incentives and the promotion of electric mobility. It included, for example, the development of a fast charging network, which is rather in a small country such as here. For example, now we have every 85 kilometers one fast charging station. So this is a very clear signal also for private vehicle users that they can make larger distances. And I think this is an opportunity for smaller countries. We're implementing a couple of pilot projects, for example, with electric buses. Our project with the financing from the German government brings 3 electric buses. And now also 12 private bus operators are joining in. And each of them is also buying another electric bus. So because there's also this this target of the law that every 2 years the fleet has to be shifted 5% to electric buses. So there's also very strong pressure from political side. And on the other hand, it has been created a preferential tariff for e-bus charging. So the price for e-bus charging at night will be very competitive. And yeah, this will be also a very strong incentive for many operators to shift. Because this is one challenging factor. In Costa Rica, there's no subsidy for public transport. So it's really a challenging topic to invest more into the vehicles. And one last point, here in Costa Rica, it was super important that the civil society engagement, it's called ASOMOVE, it's an association of vehicle users, and they promote the development of electric vehicles, for example, organizing exhibitions, not only on cars, but also on bicycles to promote the topic. They are available for questions and answers from the public. And they have a podcast. They are very visible on social media. So this is also something that can really encourage the change. And for example, Monica Araya, she is like the, I don't know, but in before I came to Costa Rica, I saw her in TED Talks around the world presenting the strategy of Costa Rica. So it's good to help these kind of persons to grow and to present, because they also have a certain outreach and visibility to push a certain topic. And it's like a self-fulfilling prophecy, I think, also a little bit, that the development will follow up. Mm-hmm. So, and here I'm coming to a very, very short resume. Next slide, please. So basically what we want to leave here as our final message is that it should be considered not only to look into electric cars, but taking into account the different types of vehicles, like delivery vehicles, e-scooters, e-bikes, to promote electric mobility while working also on the electricity grid and not to wait until the conditions are perfect. And to communicate not only the environmental benefits, but also the society benefits. So thank you very much for your attention, and we are happy to answer your questions.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Denzinger and Mr. Valenti. After that presentation with very good insights, experiences, and also the global outlook, the global market overview, we will move to our next poll. And would like to ask all the participants, what is the most important factor for you in deciding to purchase an electric vehicle? Is it costs? Is it the maintenance that might be difficult? Is it environmental concerns? Is it the range or range, do you have any range anxiety, or is it also the aesthetics of the car? I see that we are having here two polls at the same time. One closed and the other one was still running, or is that just on my screen?
I think that's just on your screen.
Okay, sorry, then that was a mistake. But my connection is a little bit unstable, please excuse. What we see now is that costs are definitely the most determining factor in the purchase decision of an electric vehicle, but also maintenance or reduced maintenance compared to internal combustion engine vehicles, and environmental concerns rank pretty high with participants at around 30%. Thank you very much for these insights. And with this intervention, we will move on to discuss the main pillars of the regional electric vehicle strategy of innovation, intelligence, and electrification. And our first speaker in this regard is Mr. Xavier Gordon, the owner and president of Exergy Energy, a clean energy development firm based in Toronto, Canada, that is specialized in solar PV, energy storage, and electric transportation options. He will address a range of imminent issues around innovations that are necessary to support an EV market within CARICOM or can spin off from there, such as charging infrastructure and connectivity. Mr. Gordon, welcome. You have the floor.
Cornelia, can you give me sharing? Or Martin?
Martin, can you please facilitate?
Okay, great. Can everyone hear me? Cornelia, can you hear me?
Yes, we hear you well. Loud and clear.
Okay, perfect. All right, thank you guys very much. So I'll do a quick introduction to Exergy and what we're doing in the region. We'll key in on some of the innovations when we're talking about the electrification of transportation across the region. So Exergy Energy, you know, again, we work across three major technologies: energy storage, solar PV, and electric transportation. We design, build, operate, consult, and deploy. So design, build, and operate solar PV, energy storage, and charging infrastructure. We do consult with utilities, governments, and development institutions when it comes to electric transportation across the region, the Caribbean. We've been doing so for about 3 years, and we also work on deploying.
Yeah, sorry to interrupt. If you just go to display settings, we're seeing your notes, not the.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
How's that?
Display settings, then go swap presented.
How about that?
It hasn't changed yet.
Okay. Still hasn't moved?
But it appears you have a presentation mode also at the bottom to switch.
Yeah. Let's in slideshow. How's that?
We just lost your screen. So please share the screen again.
How about that?
Perfect.
Yes, perfect. Thank you very much.
No worries. Okie dokie. So we design, build, operate, consult, and deploy. So in the major fields of solar PV energy storage and charging infrastructure, we design, build, and operate portfolios of systems. We do a lot of consulting when it comes to utilities, especially for charging infrastructure and governments when it comes to electric transport policy, as well as assessing fleets. So we are of the view that fleets are one of the important leading institutions that can help with the adoption of electric transportation across the region. And we also work on deploying fleets as well, too. You know, for the company, we manage quite a bit of systems here in Southern Ontario, including some of the highest rated public DC fast chargers in Canada, and in portfolios of residential and commercial EV chargers. In 2017, working with the Jamaica Public Service Company, we did the first empirical EV fleet study in the region, where we actually took a look at their meter reading fleet and gave them some empirical data on whether electrification makes sense for them. And the data was really good because it was an island-wide display set, and we were able to really prove to them that by electrifying their fleet, and this sort of data set can be shared across a number of different use cases, that electrification makes sense across the region. You know, in the previous poll, we talked about costs being one of the major factors that are sort of holding people back from purchasing electric vehicles. But studies like this show, and you know, the actual use cases all across the world for you know at least the last 5 to 6 years have shown that when it comes to total cost of ownership, electric vehicles are superior to an internal combustion engines. It has been that way for about 3 years, and it's continuing to be that way, mainly because electric vehicle prices are coming down, battery prices are coming down, so more and more you're finding it far more useful for people when you're looking at the total cost of ownership to have an electric vehicle. Now, the caveat for that is obviously how much you use the car. Where electric vehicles make a lot of sense is in the operation of the vehicles. So if you have a vehicle that you're barely driving, and you're just going from point A to point B, you're doing 10, 15 kilometers a day, maybe electric vehicles don't make a lot of sense from a cost perspective immediately right now. But the higher the usage rate, electric vehicles just make that much more sense because they're significantly cheaper to operate. And that's even when we take into account the fact that in most of the Caribbean, electricity prices are relatively high, but the efficiency when it comes to an electric motor and the system is so much superior compared to an internal combustion engine, whether that's gasoline or diesel, that it makes complete economic sense. And that's just taking away the environmental concerns as well, too, and the energy security concerns when it comes to the fact that theoretically and growing so more practically, electricity can produce domestically. We're also working with the Jamaica Public Service Company this year and deploying the first national EV charging network across the Caribbean that'll be owned and operated by the utility. For our work, you know, we work primarily in deploying fleets and working with charging infrastructure, both private and publicly owned. Our experience really has talked about, you know, charging infrastructure as one of the key indicators to helping a mobility market succeed. So what we've seen in some of the more successful areas like Barbados, which is, you know, probably a good 4 to 5 years ahead of most places in the Caribbean, is that private public charging infrastructure has really helped with the sale and the adoption rate of electric vehicles. And so we find in our business case that we presented to the Jamaica Public Service Company was more from a marketing point of view. If you're able to deploy public charging, people will have the confidence in being able to buy and use electric vehicles for their everyday use, both for private users as well as for fleets or commercial users as well, too. When it comes to things like regulation, the innovation needs to take place when it comes to help incentivize adoption, both for private and public users. So again, working in Jamaica with the Jamaica Public Service Company, we did make a rate case submission to the Office of Utility Regulation to introduce a public charging rate into the rate base. And that's to help, one, have attractive pricing for people to use public charging, and two, to let them know that this is sort of here to stay and it can be relied upon. We're also working with them on looking at, you know, exploring sort of innovative ways of helping to shift usage and charging in a way that can protect the integrity of the grid. So things like time of use and ensuring that people are plugging in their vehicles and they're plugging them at times where it's conducive to the utility for them to actually allow charging to happen. So that's typically done through things like pricing signals. So for instance, here in Ontario, we have a daytime peak, and so electricity is more expensive. So I'm more inclined to plug in my electric vehicles in the evening when the rates are low, and that helps preserve the integrity of the grid. Jamaica is a different case where they have an evening peak. So having rates where people plug in perhaps later in the evening or throughout the day make a lot more sense for Jamaicans. So the regulator and the utility can work on sort of unlocking those sorts of business models and innovations to help drive that both, you know, financial benefit to the customer as well as system integrity as well for the utility. When it comes to scaling, and I think that's one of the big problems, I did see a question in the question and answer when it comes to being able to attract things like manufacturers and the supply chain of electric vehicles from the global supply chain, it still remains a challenge across the region because, you know, individually countries tend to be pretty small, and so it's very hard to get the attention of a manufacturer to be able to supply electric vehicles. But the solution to that is really working regionally, and that's why the REVs is a very good conduit for that. If we can all work together on achieving procurement and standardizing procurement as much as possible, that will allow us to be able to really get better pricing and better supply chain of electric vehicles into the marketplace. Government fleets are also a very attractive way of helping attract scale. So we've seen in several markets across the region, Bermuda, Bahamas, most of the bees, Barbados as well too, have sort of mandated that within their government fleets, they are going to be switching or mandating that electric vehicles, or at the very least hybrid electric vehicles, are part of their procurement going forward, which helps to, you know, help the scaling of electric vehicle supply into the marketplace. A further action would be, you know, pushing that into the transport market and to the transit market. Again, we've seen that happen in Bermuda, where Bermuda, I think, just closed a tender for procuring electric buses. Barbados did that last year, and I think those electric buses should be arriving any week now. Probably Antonio can probably tell us a little bit more about that, but we're starting to see that push. Jamaica has put out a tender for electric buses as well. Antigua and Barbuda has done that as well. We know Trinidad has one already sort of available for from a pilot perspective. So again, pushing those sorts of procurements through some government agencies or at least public service agencies is a great way to start to build that scale, both in terms of supply chain, forcing the utility and the regulators to be able to start to answer some of those questions, as well as some of the soft skills, making sure that there are enough technicians available, make sure that there's charging businesses available and charging services available for that. As well too. So for us, we see the innovation coming with some things like procurement. And then the last untapped area for innovation in the marketplace is probably going to be tourism, which is a big sector of most economies across the region. Again, tourism is responsible for a lot of the transportation emissions across the region when you're talking about airplanes or transporting tourists. And so we see that as a potential area where we can now start to expand and looking into helping electrify electric mobility. That's it for me.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gordon. That was a very good look into the innovation pillar that has to be addressed by the REPs, highlighting both innovation in public-private charging infrastructure or provision of charging infrastructure overall, innovations that are necessary in incentives to encourage the uptake of electric vehicles, innovative approaches in collaborating to achieve scale, and procurement policies and governmental fleets I took away are a good option for that, and also innovation in tourism as a lever to achieve a stronger deployment of electric vehicles. Thank you very much for that intervention. We would now move to our next poll to the participants. And ask the participants for their opinion if the charging infrastructure should be utility managed or utility operated. What are your views from the perspective you are right now? All right. Thank you very much for voting. We are up by about 70% of participants. And we have a very diverse picture of the opportunities in the room, whether charging infrastructure shall be utility managed or operated. It is about half-half, yes or no, or not sure. So this show is showing us that this area will require further discussion and analysis. Thank you very much for your participation. We will now move to the second pillar that is addressed under the REPS. Mr. Antonio Sili, Systems Engineer and Technical Lead for Electric Mobility at the Barbados Light and Power Company, is working to develop and expand BLPC's transportation electrification and renewable energy strategy. He will introduce considerations around the intelligence considerations of the REPS, asking how can electrification of transportation and also the greater intelligence derived from connected systems improve transportation planning and transportation operation, and how can it actually enhance benefits to commuters? Mr. Sili, please walk us through the intelligence.
All right, good morning, everyone. Can you hear me well? Okay, okay, great. So I'm about to share my screen. This will stop the other person from sharing. Okay, yes. All right, so can you see my screen now?
Yes, we can.
Okay, great. So good morning. Thank you for having me. So today I'll be doing a brief look into the Barbados Transport Board's project, the electric bus project. And what you're getting today is really a good exclusive look into the project because the committee and the Board of Transport Board has taken an approach to, you know, be a little bit low key about the project. So it was in an interest in the interest of under promising and over delivering. So you're getting a very good exclusive here right now into the project. So just a summary of the project right now. So this is going to be the biggest public transit electric bus project in the Caribbean, and we are very proud to say that. There are other electric bus projects going across, happening across the region. There's some in Antigua, St. Kitts, so you know that Trinidad would have been the first to get electric bus. But as it relates to public transit, you're going to be the first out of the gates to do this thing. And some interesting points from some of the previous panels, just by having this project has put Barbados on the map for some of these service providers in the electric mobility space to take us a little more seriously. So if you see my emails now, having been a part of this project and this procurement being out there, some of the persons I would have contacted previously with respect to charging infrastructure and that kind of stuff are now back blowing up my email. So one of the points that Xavier raised, I think, is very, very key. Just get some of these projects going and then some of the activity will naturally occur. But back to the project now. So we are going to be procuring 33 BYD buses. These should arrive in the next couple of weeks or month, hopefully. We have a little delays on the project. And when you're thinking of a project like this, if you're going to get a couple buses, it is just not so difficult a project, but when you're procuring a large amount of buses at the same time, it then becomes more of a engineering type project. So as it relates to the depots, we would have made a decision to have multiple locations. So we're going to spread these buses across three depots, 18 buses at one, 10 at another, and 5 buses at another location. I forgot to mention that there's another project happening concurrently. The Ministry of Energy and Water Resources in Barbados under their Smart Energy Fund program is also procuring another 2 buses. So these will all feed into one big electric bus project. So when you're looking into the project of this nature, you have a lot of things to consider. And charging and the charging philosophy is one of the biggest things that you need to bear in mind when you're doing a project like this. And for this project, an implementation committee would have been formed with the various key stakeholders, persons from the Ministry of Transport and Works, Transport Board, and persons like myself and the utility. And the reason you need to get everyone into the room is because really and truly, this is now one of the biggest synergies between the energy space and transportation. So you need to have a coordinated approach as you try to roll out a project of this nature. So the charging philosophy would have decided on overnight charging only and no opportunity charging. And the reason behind that is because we want to take a phased approach into this type of initiative. So some of the opportunity chargers require some big infrastructure and we don't have very big road reserves. So to implement some of those chargers would have been a little bit more complex in the first instance. So we opted for a more controlled environment, depot charging only for the first instance. As it relates to power, so this is a big, big thing. You need to consider power up front in your planning when you're looking at a project like this. We would have made the decision that we're not going to provide charging to charge all of the buses simultaneously. That will cause a significant peak on the network, and it will also incur additional charges that are not necessary to the transport authority. So managing that demand was a big factor into the project. So we are providing the capacity to charge 50 of the buses simultaneously. Each bus will have approximate three-hour charging time. And with that charging time and the dwell time of the buses, we see that we can implement a system to stagger charging and be able to comfortably charge the full range of buses at each depot within the time period. And that's where the electronic load management system comes in. So this is something that I will talk about a little bit later on in the project, but this is one of the key parts as it relates to intelligence. Having this load management system in place where you can monitor charging and be aware of any things that may not be going right in the night, that is very important if you're going to be doing a project of this nature, because it's a new way of doing things for the transport authority. So whereas they would have been fueling buses at night and everything would be perfect, they're now managing electrical system. Fleet management and monitoring, I'll talk about that later on, but that's a big component of this project and we're going to be implementing those into this initiative. Training, and last you see I have solar PV there in gray, but that's mainly because that's going to be a phase two to the project, but that's very important as well. So back to the charging. So for the transport board, I mentioned the dwell time. So basically how they currently operate, they have a very small and tight charging window. So between 11 at night and 5 in the morning is really the true downtime of buses for the transport authority. So really and truly, you have to squeeze charging into a very, very small window. So obviously we'll have some anomalies where some buses will arrive a little bit before 11 and some would arrive after. We know the last bus leaves at 12. So you have a little flexibility there, but for the purpose of the project, we would have designed with the intention that we have 6 hours dwell time and we need to charge all the buses in that period of time. So this is kind of the load that we expect from the three locations on the network. And this is what we would call a high demand, low load factor energy consumption. So by that, we have a big peak and then nothing for the rest of the day. So this kind of gives you an indication. And some of the previous panelists would have alluded to this. This is a different type of consumption to what we are accustomed to. And there's a big benefit of being able to maximize charging and optimize charging by taking advantage of what we call time of use rate. So that's something that could be added. And we are already looking at it and working on it from the light and power perspective to implement for this project. So how does electrifying public transit add value to the transportation sector in general? So the first big thing is really cost. So I don't think a lot of people, to be honest, are that keen on doing these projects strictly for the environmental benefits and that kind of stuff. These projects are driven by what is the cost benefit. If you're going to sell this to a government agency, the cost is going to be one of the biggest factors that are going to come up first. And for us, especially in this part of the world where we have, as Devon would have mentioned, high imported fossil fuel costs, this is something that you need to manage. And what we have projected for this project is that there could be a significant savings in terms of fueling just by going electric. And this is one of the biggest selling points. And this is one that we hope to prove is true by actually dispatching the buses. But we're looking at potential savings of in excess of $2 million for just 33 buses. So this is a good opportunity. And we're hoping to prove and share this information with you as we roll out the project. Maintenance costs, we're also projecting significant reduction in maintenance and an increase in the availability of buses. But while seeing that, the other biggest selling point that I would say is the improvement in the commuter experience. So here we have opportunity to reduce operational costs, but at the same time, improve the commuter experience. So in Barbados, I don't know about other territories, the only other Caribbean country that I went to and I saw AC, air conditioning on the bus, was in Trinidad. And we know that they have the benefit of subsidized fuel, so they can afford to do that. But in the other islands, air conditioning in a public bus is unheard of. So here you have the opportunity, because of the lower cost to operate, you can now offer air conditioning. You can increase the value proposition by offering USB charging, Wi-Fi, and now even making the bus more accessible. So these things may not have been necessarily specific to electric buses, but because of the reduced operational costs and the more flexibility in what you can do, you can also increase that value proposition. So this is one of the biggest things. So this is something that I think persons should be looking at and looking into, because it is another way of selling these projects. So obviously we have the environmental benefits, improvement in air quality and reduction in noise. But if you pair the reduction in operational costs and the improvement in the commuter experience, I think you may have the opportunity to get this sold to your various countries and transit operators. So leveraging technology to improve transportation planning and operation. So for our project, one of the key things that we want to do is not only execute the project and get the benefits, we want to be able to understand and be able to share information. So things such as fleet management and fleet tracking will be integral parts of the project, because we need to understand how the various inputs affect the performance. So how driver styles, routes, passenger loading, environmental conditions, and different things affect the performance of the buses, that will be very, very important, not necessarily only for this project, but for future projects across the region. Load management and smart charging. So we all identify now that with electricity, you have the benefit of variable cost throughout the day. So as a transport authority now, you have to now look at when your buses would be parked, when your buses would be on the road, and see if that aligns with the utility. And if you can find a way to maximize the off-peak periods, I think naturally this worked out well for us in Barbados. Our off-peak period was currently in line with the dwell time for Transport Board. So they have the significant opportunity to even lower their operational costs further by benefiting from a time of use rate. And that's something that we're looking at also for this project. And it's going to be a very big factor in improving the project over time.
Mr. Seeley, as much as this technology and intelligence section is a very crucial aspect of your presentation, may I ask you to wrap up with the key considerations and key messages in this section?
Okay, so the key messages really, synergy, so work with the various stakeholders into the project and bring everyone into the room and execute it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this good intervention and presentation of the Barbados experience. And I see a number of questions have been asked in the question and answer box directly to Mr. Seeley and also to Mr. Gordon. We will now like to bring up our next poll. When we think that we are moving towards a more intelligent, more interconnected transportation sector, a lot of data will have to be shared. So how comfortable are you as users of an intelligent and interconnected transportation system in sharing your data? And we gave a range between very uncomfortable to very comfortable about sharing data, as a lot of personal data and is involved in that process. Okay, thank you very much. We will close this poll now. It appears that the majority, 39% are comfortable with sharing their data, but we do have a range of feelings towards the sharing of transport related data, between very uncomfortable and very comfortable and rather neutral. So this will have to be investigated further as well. Thank you very much for your contributions. With this, we will move to Professor Chandravan Sharma, leader of the Energy Systems Program in the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering at the University of the West Indies, St. Augustine campus. He has more than 30 years of experience in academia, engineering industry, and the power sector of the Caribbean. Professor Sharma, which issues will the REFs have to consider under the electrification pillar? How can we achieve an optimal integration of electric vehicles and charging infrastructure into our power grids? Professor Sharma, we welcome your views. The floor is yours. We see the presentation up, but we do not hear you yet.
Good morning. Yeah. Are you hearing me now?
Yes, good morning, Professor Sharma.
Good morning. All right. Where most of you would have been convinced that is the e-mobility sector is where we should go to in terms of getting system moves forward. And the main reason being that we have greenhouse gas reduction, and it's for a guide, it's about 10 kilometers per kilowatt. Your operation would be like lower maintenance in the long term, and long term is really only about 5 years. Higher first cost, however, and most people talk about range anxiety, but for the Caribbean region, I mean, small islands, range is not really an issue. And most of the vehicles have about 200 kilometers that can give you for full charge, and that will take you most places and back home easily. What we are looking at, though, is if we look at the characteristics of an EV, the EV is parked home most of the time, home or in office. So most of the period of time, it is rarely not doing anything. Very short period where the reds are, that's where the actual operation of the EV is. So your EV is actually not really doing anything, but it's there stored with a lot of energy. And if we overlook that in terms of the diurnal rate, usually in terms of electricity sector, we see that most the time that it's being used is peak time. But when I come home, which is this time here, coincides to the fact that I parked it up, and most people are going to use an EV like a cell phone in terms of charging. They're going to plug this EV in to the system home, and then that's where most of the problems would come from in terms of the utility. Now, when we look at the chargers we have, the level one chargers, I'm not going to discuss because that's very small chargers, but level two and level three chargers are the ones. The level two chargers are the wall chargers that you would probably install to charge your vehicle with, and the level three are the ones what the last speaker spoke about in terms of fleet charging, which is three-phase systems, DC fast charging systems. Now, when we look at this, we, meaning us in Trinidad, we did some analysis in terms of a certain area in Trinidad. And we looked at if people came home and plug in their vehicles after a commute, what would happen to the electricity system? And what you can see here is that as we start to change the penetration rate, and penetration rate is defined in our system in terms of the number of homes that are plugging in divided by the total number of homes. So if we say we have a whole transformers where 10 homes are fed, then it means that 10% penetration means one home is plugged in to that charger, okay? Now, what we found is that from the time you reach 5% penetration rate, you start experiencing problems in terms of voltage levels on your power system. So really the system has a lot, or your power system would have a lot of voltage problems if you don't coordinate the charging system or the domestic charging on your power system. When we look at commercial charging, well, a commercial charging system is a no-no on a normal distribution network. They can only be done on the three-phase network. And if you put it on a normal domestic network, certainly 90% problems, you're going to get 90% regulation immediately. So we see commercial charges only for, commercial charging, that is type 3 charging, only relevant for fleet owners. When we look at what the stress are, we're going to get serious voltage fluctuations, degraded system economics, and increased likelihood of blackouts. When we look at our benefits, again, the benefits are, well, in terms of when we look at emission is one of the major concern and the major advantage that you get immediately. And many of the countries can get the NDC really being satisfied immediately if we have a complete change into electric vehicles in terms of our mobility, in terms of our transportation system. When I look at the renewable energy integration, if I look at solar, we see solar fluctuates here because once the sun goes out, the system drops. And what this means in this particular area is that every time it drops, there must be some backup system, and most likely is a fossil fuel system that is running on the grid that has to back this up to make sure that this does not happen, or else you're going to get an outage on the system. Wind, the same thing happens, it's even more variable than what is happening. Now you can solve these by having also batteries, but batteries are going to increase the cost tremendously. One of the best ways to do it is probably to use solar charging at home. And if you notice, this is where my peak is at 7-8 o'clock, where I'm coming home to plug the vehicle on. And if I have solar charging during the day when the vehicle is parked and not doing anything, then I can reduce my peak comfortably. I could also plug into the normal grid and do the same thing by reducing the peak. One of the things that you know about when you reduce the peak, you are going to help the load factor. And also if you help the load factor, then the RIC, the rating industry or the rate utility or the rate regulator can come in and probably negotiate a better rate for customers. A normal electric vehicle with about 6 kilowatts of charge could probably run a whole house in terms of once I have a charger which can feed back into my system. But this also is a cost, this charger. So I can have this as my standby power for my system. But one of the other things that we forget to take into consideration is that once I'm looking at using my electric vehicle for standby power or for peak shaving, my charger must be aggregated by some controller, some internet device where the aggregator is being controlled by the transmission system operator. And this is the person who is going to decide how all this is going to happen. I cannot just plug it in and hope everything is going to be hunky-dory, else it's going to be a total hodgepodge of what is going up, going down, and you are going to destroy your power system. The power system right now, you know, is here. And to get it to where you want to be, to control your system, I need to have an advanced metering infrastructure, which many of the companies don't have yet, but Trinidad has one, where now once I can put that, I now can now put onto that layer several options where I can now dynamically control the charging and where the charging is coming from. Having done that, we have developed at the Faculty of Engineering an app with the electronics to control the charging time and when you can charge from the utility. So the utility is the one gives the permission to the app to allow the charger, which is this here, this junction box there, to charge the system, and it will only charge when it is you want to charge it or when the utility says you can charge, so that you don't get any kind of congestion on the network. The dynamic coordination can be remotely controlled, increase the power output depending on the committed generation and additional units, and utility can incentivize the customers that are EV load owners to provide a wide window duration where possible. We at the Faculty of Engineering have our own electric vehicle platform where we are working on these systems. We have done a lot of work in the area and we have done a lot of analysis of the grids, and most of the grids in the Caribbean are weak grids, meaning their short circuit levels are very low and they're subjected to very difficult or very low voltages once you put a load on them, once you don't ensure that you don't change or don't get involved in the charging characteristic of your system. So one has to be very careful with you. Your utility has to be very much in control, else your reliability is going to go through the window if you don't take control of how you control the charging of your electric vehicle. But that being said, it can be done, but one must know what you are doing to ensure that you maintain the reliability of your grid and also have the ability to go to e-mobility. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Sharma, for this very important contribution regarding the electrification pillar of our regional electric vehicle strategy. We will have another poll asking participants whether they would be willing to offer their own electric vehicle to provide grid services, or whether there are any considerations with regards to battery degradation or any other concerns in sharing the vehicle. All right, thank you very much for your participation in this poll. We will end the poll now. We see that about half of the participants, 52%, would be willing to offer their own electric vehicle for grid services. 35% are not sure yet, and 15% said no. We would be interested, of course, in the reasons for your decision, but we will see how much time we will have for the question and answer section. For now, thank you very much for your contribution. And with this, we finally move to Mr. Mike Stritsky, who is the founder of the Hydrogen House Project and the highly renowned pioneer in fuel cell electric vehicles. He will give us an outlook to the future and provide us with a tour of his Hydrogen House project, which is headquartered in New Jersey, and also explain how hydrogen-powered fuel cells work and which opportunities and options could exist for the Caribbean region. Mr. Stritsky, please take over and give us a tour through your house.
I believe they're on mute.
Yes, Mr. Stritsky.
Okay, can you hear us?
Mr. Chu? Yes, now we can hear you.
Great. Go ahead, Mike.
Hi, my name is Mike Stritsky. Welcome, everybody, to the first solar hydrogen fuel cell home in North America, and soon not to be the last. There are already 270,000 of them in Japan, and it's going to be growing around the world as we're starting to adopt fuel cells. To speak to electric vehicles real quickly, electric vehicles and fuel cell vehicles are the same thing, only without the batteries. So fuel cells have been used reliably in outer space for the last 70 years to provide the astronauts with their electricity. So I'm going to give you a brief tour on how everything in my home, how it all connects. So what you see behind me is my storage tanks. They're regular old propane tanks, and they were built in 1972. They have an endless lifespan as long as you keep them. 120 days worth of storage for me. I have 26 kilowatts of solar here that provides all that's turned into hydrogen. The vehicle that I'm standing next right here is a solar hydrogen Polaris Ranger. I build these things for
Mr. Stritsky, sorry for interrupting, but we only see the video as a still picture. We do not see an actual video right now.
Is that better?
On my screen, the picture is frozen with Mr. Stritsky standing next to a vehicle.
Okay, hold on. We're going to off video on. How's that? Better? How's that? Is that better?
I do not see it yet.
How's that? You go inside down.
How's that? No.
Is that clear?
We don't see a picture. I would suggest that if the video now it's up again, I would suggest if it is not working, then you could send us a recording. We will probably have your intervention very briefly, yeah. And you send us a recording and we share that with participants after the webinar.
Cornelia, it works now though, right?
Cornelia, it shows as a still picture again.
Okay. So what we could do is we could send a...
Right here, you should be able to be right by the antenna. You see it?
That doesn't work, does it?
Make sure you're on the outside.
Damn it. Okay. Hold.
Okay, got some picture now.
Is that better? Okay. There we go. All right, we'll do this quickly.
So explain the... Yeah, all this.
So Mike, go ahead.
Okay. Can you see the Ranger?
Yep.
This vehicle is an electric vehicle powered with fuel cells and batteries, so it's a hybrid. The vehicle itself has solar, so as long as it's sitting in the sun, it's charging. These are flexible sun-powered cells. It has a hydrogen storage tank on it, high pressure, and it has a plug power fuel cell on it. This has a 230-mile range on a single refill, so it has a lot of advantages over a traditional electric vehicle in that this can charge from two sources. So you get charged from the hydrogen and you get charged from the sun. The vehicle itself we use all around the farm here. It has a winch. This will also power a home. It has a 18 kilowatt inverter on it that will power 240 volt single phase as well as 115 volts. So this will also plug into my home. It'll plug into my jewel box, my lawnmower, or my motorcycle. It can all be run off of this. And all these units will plug together to make one unit. So if you needed a lot of power for one thing, there are auxiliary plugs that plug into one another. So the fuel cell, the car, the jewel box are all done off of independent or even with different power supply, just like a transformer. So I actually fill a Toyota Mirai from my home. So what you see is a portable refueling station. You could dump a dozen of these around the island and just go around and fill them up as necessary. So this vehicle, as you can see, is plugged in to fill the Mirai. If you pan over to your left, you can see my hydrogen high pressure refueling station. So this station here takes low pressure hydrogen, steps it up to 6,000 pounds, and that's what powers the car. Like I said, these could be dropped all over the island and they could just fill right from there. You run a truck around the island once a day. When the station signals it's low, you just go ahead and fill it. You're looking at companies like Nikola, who recently went public doing tractor trailers. So they're doing refuels of a tractor, class 8 tractor trailer that can fill up in 15 minutes and go 600 miles. A lot of Europe is adapting this technology now because this is the cure for the disease rather than the treatment. Fuel cells get the same amount of energy every single cycle and they'll last 25 years. Batteries in hot climates don't do very well, basically because of the heat and the cycle life. So this is a much better solution. You get the same amount of power out for 25 years, not diminishing over time. The fuel cell vehicles are 100% recyclable.
You don't have to worry about what you're going to do with the batteries. So this is a game changer in that you can actually fill up just like a regular car. The only emissions is water. So you're looking at this vehicle producing 12 gallons of drinking water every tank point. So, you know, I drove this car to the Mojave Desert. I drank the water in Death Valley. I've got 10,000 miles on this car made from homemade hydrogen, made from solar and water. But there are lots of other sources for hydrogen. We can do it off of biomass. We can do it off of sewage. 80% of every molecule in the universe is hydrogen. So basically we can get it from everything. Anything that's organic can be turned into hydrogen. In Japan, they're turning sewage into methane, into hydrogen to run vehicles. Same thing with landfills, any kind of food waste, breweries. All of this can be done. So hydrogen is the universal fuel. You're never going to run out of it. And it's around us anywhere. Sources of renewable that you can make hydrogen and store forever basically is wind, solar, biomass, sewage. All of these can be used, even wind action, wave action. So we've got to go to an economy that's basically sustainable. This would provide the perfect solution for an island. So in my house, I do cooking gas, heating gas, fuel for my vehicles, my lawnmower, my motorcycle, my boat are all run off of solar hydrogen. I've lived here for the last 17 years refining the systems. And now it's becoming commercial. Every single automaker is now producing fuel cell vehicles, trucks, buses, trains in Europe. They're doing gasification of natural gas from wind to hydrogen. So this looks like this is what's going to replace the fossil fuel era. So this is the cure for the disease, not the treatment. I have no vested interest in any of this other than getting the information out and letting people know that there's something else on the menu. And this is, you know, Toyota bet the entire company on this by releasing 5,500 patents free to the world. I know this works. So if you want something that works, take a good, hard, long look at hydrogen, because this is happening quickly, just like cell phones. Okay, we're gonna take a walk up to my house and with my fuel cell ranger, and I'll show you some of the other things. You wanna go in the garage or are we gonna lose it? We're gonna lose it. Okay. So on a day like today, we're actually making hydrogen. I have two hydrogen generators going that are filling my tanks.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but we are losing both audio and video right now.
We had to go through that back.
Okay. I am very sorry, but we lost audio and video connection. The video is coming on and off, but we lost your audio as well. Should we wrap up at this point, and would you want to send us a recording to present the hydrogen house, and we will share it with all the attendees and panelists?
Nadia, she can distribute it to everyone, just a little bit more of a overview of everything here. Can you hear us right now?
Yes, I can hear you, but the video stopped again. So I would suggest that we wrap up, and we will be very happy to share the video with all the participants and attendees.
Okay. Yeah. Well, thank you. Yeah. We'll wrap.
I could go to the website Hydrogen for more information.
Excellent.
Thank you everyone.
Very much.
All right,
for
there
you.
Are lots of it on YouTube.
Thank you very much for your contribution. We are losing the audio. We will be happy to share any links and any materials with all the attendees and panelists of the webinar. If you send them to us, we will make sure that these are distributed. Thank you very much for this interesting tour and insight into fuel cell electric vehicles. Well, And we have brought up our last poll for today, whether you would be interested in learning more about fuel cell electric vehicles. And I see 95% agreement rates. So yes, our participants and attendees would be very happy to receive further information from you and on the technology. So thank you very much for the intervention. We will now move to Dr. Gardner to quickly run us through the expectations, timelines, and modalities for the full articulation for the regional electric vehicle strategy. And then we will see if you can still give us a few minutes of your valuable time for one or two questions, or whether we need to close off the webinar already. Dr. Gardner, over to you.
Thank you very much, Cornelia. Good afternoon now, colleagues. It's no longer morning. And thank you for indulging and staying with us throughout this very interesting and informative webinar. Now, what we have attempted to do is to frame the considerations that are being written into the regional electric vehicle strategy. The three pillars, as I mentioned earlier, were presented on the pillar of innovation, the pillar of intelligence, and the pillar of electrification. And those three pillars are underpinned by what we would call platforms. And those platforms are in relation to capacity building, policy and regulations, and naturally financing. Because as one former Prime Minister of Jamaica said, it takes cash to care. And we know that very well here in the Caribbean. The point is that we are at a stage where we are about to go to procurement to bring in a consultant who will take this significant body of knowledge that we have realized within the region and electric vehicles. Although it is that we do not have a mainstream electric vehicle sector, there is a lot of information based on electric mobility that different countries are doing in different, with different degrees of, if you want to call it intensity, different degrees of focus, different stakeholders who are driving it in different areas. We have, in the case of Barbados, private sector-led opportunities that have been explored. In the case of Jamaica, government-led opportunities that have been explored. In the case of Trinidad and Tobago, university-led opportunities being explored. You have utilities also in Jamaica and Belize and Guyana who are doing quite a bit of work, and so we are bringing all of that together. Work that has been to a large extent the basis on which we established an electric vehicle working group. Curtis spoke to you earlier about some of how that work would have emerged, and that work is going to be crystallized and synthesized into a detailed strategy. We expect that the procurement will start, meaning the RFP will go out by the 1st of July. The expectation is that that will take probably about 3 months or so. We are doing it under the GIZ-sponsored TAPSEC program. So that will go out as a TAPSEC consultancy. Within 3 months, we expect that procurement process, it will be an international tender, because it's quite a large activity. That process will be completed in terms of the procurement. We will then have a consultant on board, hopefully, July, August, September, by the beginning of October at worst case. And we expect that within 6 months of that consultant being on board, we should have a strategy that we would be able to validate in a technical sense and get approved at the political level. So we're going to hopefully have the draft available, hopefully in January, February, and we'll take it through a round of technical validations across the region before it gets political approval by the energy ministers in CARICOM level. So by this time next year, we should have a very detailed regional electric vehicle strategy. And in the meantime, different aspects of the strategy would be emerging as we go along the line. And we would be doing projects that are consistent with what is being pursued within the context of the strategy. Because we are not, as the colleague from GIZ said, waiting on the perfect storm. But while we develop the strategy, we are already designing and developing projects with the understanding that projects are improving strategy and strategy are, of course, informing projects. So we are riding both strands at the same time. So colleagues, I want to thank you. We see hydrogen from the Secretariat as having an important role to play. The timing of when hydrogen will become, if you want to call it, streamlined or mainstreamed within the strategy is something that we will have to look at, but definitely there will be a role for hydrogen, which is one of the reasons why we asked for those, that hydrogen presentation this morning. We see that there are many opportunities already being explored where hydrogen is concerned. We see in Trinidad and Tobago, there is some discussion going on around natural gas-based hydrogen production. In the case of some of the OECS countries, in particular Dominica, there is discussion happening where we're talking about geothermal-based hydrogen once that geothermal project is completed. And of course, in other countries, there are opportunities and options for solar and other types of hydrogen and wind hydrogen. So colleagues, it has been a good morning and so far, good afternoon. Thank you very much. Here ends my my input, and I will leave it up to Cornelia, and hopefully you can find 5 minutes or so to have probably a couple of questions and then wrap. Thank you very much, colleagues. Have a good day all.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gardner, for this important outlook on the development of the regional electric vehicle strategy. I would see that most of the questions have been answered in our question and answer box. There are two questions that are still open, apart from some discussions on who could support in the Caribbean region, that I would like to address. And I hope participants will give us another 5 minutes to do that. So one of the questions was whether micromobility, meaning electric scooters or electric bicycles, could be a suitable solution for islands that would be less able to deploy the infrastructure required for a bigger electric vehicle system. I would ask one of the panelists to take up the answer. Maybe Mr. Gordon or Mr. Seeley, who would like to answer that?
I can take a shot at it.
Of course, Professor Sharma, thank you very much.
The infrastructure required for electric vehicles, meaning cars, are not as big as people think. It's something at home. Like I said before, in small islands, range anxiety is not a problem. So you don't need to have public charging system for cars to get it going, because most cars can traverse about 200 kilometers on a full battery charge, so that you can go home every day and recharge your system. The only problem, the only issue you would have is that the utility must get involved to ensure the coordination of the charges. In terms of microsystems, meaning scooters and electric bicycles and so forth, that can always happen, and that's a user preference. And really it has to do with, in terms of getting lanes for that give these people preferences, because one of the problem you have with the Caribbean environment is the roads are very narrow. And you have problems in terms of vehicles and two-wheelers fighting for the same road. And that's what keeping back a lot of bicycles from being used for transportation too. So it can happen. You don't need any kind of fancy infrastructure. That's something at home, electrical infrastructure, but you need something to do with the road infrastructure. Thank you.
If I could add on to that as well too, there is a combination between public charging and private charging. So certainly, like Dr. Sharma said, in smaller islands, the need for public charging is reduced greatly, not like large countries like, let's say, Canada. However, where we sort of differ in that opinion is that because the public is coming from the mindset where you need public refueling stations, having public charging infrastructure, it's less about utility and more about marketing and promoting the technology. So to help influence adoption of electric vehicles, we do suggest that utilities make minimal investments in public charging infrastructure so that people feel safe and comfortable knowing that if for whatever reason I don't have power available at my house, or maybe I lived in a temporary situation, I'm renting, or I live in something like an apartment building or a condo where I may not necessarily have the capacity to put up my own private charging station, that I still have something publicly available. And this is sort of following the Tesla model of build it and they will come. Usually before Tesla enters into a marketplace, they put up a large amount of public charging infrastructure available for Tesla users, even though Tesla users very rarely need to use public charging because they have big giant batteries. They typically charge at home and they tend to be wealthier, so they can afford to have private charging. They still like the assurance of knowing that that public charging is available. So from a technical point of view, do we need a lot of public charging stations, big giant fast charging stations? Probably not in the Caribbean, but it is an important first mover to get people out of internal combustion engines into electric vehicles.
Yeah, hi. This is Mike Stritsky, Hydrogen House Project. I was involved in a project in China a few years ago where they did fuel cell powered scooters. And the way they did that is they put in these like vending machines to fill cylinders like this that you could pop in and pop out. And they were sold at 7-Eleven or they were at different convenience stores. So you could actually charge these at home, or you could actually just go to a vending machine and drop them in the scooter, get about 100 miles worth of range. So this is something that's on the line of doing that, where you can use renewable and people could do this at home, or they could use it from a regular infrastructure. But the company was called Asia Pacific Fuel Cells, and you can look up the project. They did one of these in Hawaii, but it looks like this is going to be the norm. Hope that helps with having all the flavors on the table.
Okay, thank you very much to all the speakers on this contribution. I have one last question, which was posted rather early on by Mr. Hugh Seeley. If the prediction is for 60 million electric vehicles by 2014, which would make up 3.5% of the market, and if total vehicles stayed at 1.7 billion, question is, should CARICOM also have a regional biofuel strategy for transport to facilitate the emission mitigation ambitions in the NDCs? Mr. Gardner, would you like to address this question as a last point before we close?
Certainly. Thanks a lot. I had intended to have a private conversation with Mr. Seeley and this, but of course, since it has come up, it's good to have it in this audience. CARICOM has actually, through the Secretariat, looked at a number of options for biofuel strategy for the transport sector. The 5Cs, which is the Caribbean Community Climate Change Center, an institution of CARICOM, has also done quite a bit of work in supporting some of the examination of biofuel options. The truth is that biofuels, on the one hand, there's some amount of controversy with biofuels, depending on the production of biofuels, how it is produced and where it is produced, whether it is you're using certain types of crops, in the case of ethanol-based biofuel that would have used sugarcane, in the case of the Caribbean consideration to produce ethanol. That is something that is not, if you want to call it, being promoted globally because of the use of food crops for fuel. It's not a promoted concept or principle. Then there is the land competition, where there is also discussions around whether arable lands or farmlands that could be used towards foods or other developmental purposes should really be put into biofuels, especially when there are other fuel options for the Caribbean. So it's not that biofuels wouldn't be able to serve a purpose, but the question is, compared to other opportunities, would this be the best use of resource? And so far, it is seeming to us that the biofuel opportunities and options for transport is not the best for the Caribbean. All the studies we have done so far have not pointed us in a direction that suggests that we should pursue a biofuel strategy. We have done a lot of work over the last 6 years, 5Cs, CARICOM. We did a complete biofuel analysis of all the countries to understand where would the sources be, what could be produced from those sources, whether it is electricity or liquid fuels for transport. We see opportunities for small-scale biofuels for
say, biogas production that could be used for either electricity or small amounts of transport, especially in farming communities, where you could have biogas fueled cars or tractors and so on, but nothing that we see as a commercial scale rollout at this point in time. That's not what the studies do not support that. No, maybe it will change later, but even in a country like Suriname, they did work on opportunities for bioethanol production from sugar cane, looking at the Brazil model, because of course Suriname is next to Brazil and there was not much encouragement from those studies. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gardner, for this comprehensive reply. I want to thank all of our panelists for their excellent contributions and timekeeping. And I hope that all the participants enjoyed our presentations and discussions. We will, as we announced, share all the materials from the webinar, both on the CCREEE website and on the CARIC platform. So all the presentations and also video recordings from the Hydrogen House project will be available for you shortly. And we thank you very much for your continued interest in electric mobility, and we look forward to the development of the full regional electric vehicle strategy. Thank you very much all, and have a great day.